we are here on the regeneration felling site, and this is where the story of the new Metsä begins. Can you tell us a little bit more?
Yeah, you are exactly right. So basically, this is the starting point for a new commercial forest. So there has been like regeneration felling last winter when there was like a lot of snow on the ground. And then after the snow melted, so we did the soil preparation. And then we already planted the new tree growing there. And so the soil preparation is made with sort of like a big scoop. And we take the mold and turn it upside down. And then by that, well, so we ensure warmth, fertility, and also like the prevent the competition from other plants on the ground. So the seedling here gets a really nice start for its growth. So we do the soil preparation as mild as possible, but still so that we ensure the growth for the seedling. And we try to keep like the open space as short as possible in to produce a new forest.
This regeneration felling looks like we've taken all the trees out, but still some are left and some other features also. Can you explain why this looks like it does now?
Oh, yes. So yes, we have taken some trees away from the forest, but still something are left behind. For example, there over there you can see the buffer zone towards the water over there. Then we have left retention trees behind me. Also, there are like dead wood standing, and also there's decaying wood on the ground. And also one thing that we do is that we like cut like a tree from 2 to 5 meters length, and it's called a biodiversity stump. And all these things we do because they enhance or improve the biodiversity in the forest. So this is like sort of like normal nature management in our commercial forest, and which is of course taken into account in all forestry operations.
And it's important to leave all this dead wood or decaying wood here. Why?
So there are quite a huge number, like thousands of different kind of species which are somehow dependent on decaying wood on different stages. For example, like the species on, for example, the stumps, mm-hmm. are different than in the decaying wood lying on the ground or still standing.
Yeah,
and also it's important to leave like different tree species because quite many tree species have like their specialist species dependent exactly on them.
Okay, so a lot of actions towards biodiversity.
Yes.
Well, then, what about forest certification? What role does that play in all this?
It gives us some quite many requirements concerning like the biodiversity things. For example, the number of retention trees or buffer zones. But also like an important thing is that like it's not only biodiversity which is ensured in certification, forest certification, but it also takes into account social and economical aspects. For example, the workers' rights working here for us in the forest.
Mm-hmm. Do you know if this forest was certified?
Yes, it's certified with two different schemes. So like the most common ones, BFC and FSC. So this is actually double certified. And also when we certify forests, so we also, it like gives like a good starting point to also know the origin of the wood that we use.
And that's very important to know where the wood is coming from.
Yeah. Yeah. Like knowing that we do stuff legally and sustainably.
So now we are in a place where the regeneration took place about 4 years ago, right? Can you tell me a little bit what's going on here after that?
These spruces here are already like some maybe 1 meter long, depending a little bit on the seedling where it is located. And also, as you can see, so it's not only spruces that are growing here, but we have like a lot of different tree species over here already. For example, we have rowan here behind me. Then we also have aspen and birch growing here naturally. So they were not regenerated like by hand. And yeah, a lot of different kind of like there's like after the regeneration felling 4 years, so you can definitely see that it's not like an open place anymore, but there are like a lot of different kind of plants here. For example, what is quite mentionable at the moment that for the multiple use of our forest, that there has been like a really good party for the pollinators in the springtime, and now like in the late summer, so we will get like a huge amount of raspberries to be eaten right here.
So you could call this a pollinator paradise, I suppose.
Yeah, in the springtime, yes.
Yeah. So now we are in a young forest. These trees are about 8 years old or so. What has happened here so far?
Okay, yeah, you're right. This is like an 8 year old, or these trees have been, spruces have been here for 8 years. And before that, there was like a regeneration felling, soil preparation, inverting the soil, and then the spruces have been planted. And as you can see, so these 8 year old trees, they have grown quite rapidly lately. And as you can see, so the birches behind us, so they are growing even more rapidly than the spruces here. It's interesting to see how the sort of like the competition between different trees here is affecting the growth.
And it's still, when this side is being cleared, I can still see quite a lot of birch and other trees than spruce. I suppose that's one of the important features, to leave all kinds of trees, even in a thinning site.
Oh, yes. We know that like the composition of different tree species is quite important for the biodiversity. And when we do the clearing, or when we do the thinning, tending, so we only like clear those areas or those trees which are negatively affecting the growth of the spruce that we have chosen to be like a large tree in the future.
Mm-hmm. So more species means more biodiversity in the forest.
Basically,
it's quite
simple.
Yeah. All right. So what will happen next here?
I guess like we will need a tending maybe in 5 years to give more space to the spruces. And maybe 20 years from now, so there will be the first thinning, which is the first commercial thinning. So it means like the forest owner gets some income from the felling.
And in that first commercial, you mean that then the wood that is taken out, it's used commercially in the pulp process, I suppose. It's not very thick logwood yet.
Yeah,
in the first thinning.
Completely right. Yeah. So yes, the trees are not that large in diameter just yet, but the idea is to give space for the rest of the trees to go wider and wider, and the smaller trees which are taken away from the forest, so they are produced to pulp and then of course to paper and board.
Mm-hmm. And bioenergy, I suppose.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
All right. Thank you. So now we are on the second thinning site, which is about 60 years old. There has been a previous thinning before. What can you tell me about this site? What was done recently and what was done before?
Yeah, so there was like a second thinning, or maybe actually third thinning. Like it took place last winter. So we take away some of the trees and decide which trees we want to leave to grow more width, which is of course it's like the most valuable part for the forest owner.
All right. So what happens? I can see that this, for example, is about this big, this log that has been taken here. What happens with that?
Yeah, so like the wood that we take away from the forest, it's used 100%. So the thickest part of the tree, it's used for sawmill or veneer. And then the thinner parts, they are used for pulp, so paper and board. And then the top of the tree and branches are used for energy production. And in the previous thinning, it's always like the same idea that like we use always the thickest parts for the best use. For example, in the first thinning, it's like the first commercial thinning. It's where we like the smallest parts are taken for pulp production, and it helps the rest of the trees to grow to logs. I mean, like sawn logs.
Okay, and that's the most valuable part of the tree, I suppose. The bigger the log, the better.
Yeah.
All right. Now we are in this valuable habitat in Finland, an herb-rich forest. Can you tell me a little bit about what it is?
Yeah, of course. So these herb-rich forests, they are quite a rare habitat here in Finland. Because like naturally they are quite rare, and also we have, because of the like the fertile soil we have here, so we haven't actually like taken them into for agricultural use. So and this, so these are, because of they are so fertile and rich, so these are also the most rich habitats in terms of biodiversity. So a lot of different kind of species here, and also quite rare to have this common hazel here. And also the common hazel is one of the like most important reasons why this habitat is actually protected where that we are in at the moment.
All right, so the soil is like in a garden in a way.
Yeah, sort of, yeah. So the soil here is quite different from the soil that we have in like normal boreal forests. So it's like mineral land, and this is more like soil that we use in the gardens. Mm-hmm. So very fertile and nice. And actually, right. I just noticed that, as you see, so there is actually like a hazel nut here, which have maybe starts growing at some point.
All right.
And yeah, so also like some characteristics from this herb-rich forest, why the reason why this is protected is also that we have like a lot of decaying wood over there, which is very important for the biodiversity in our forests.
Mm-hmm. Some very specific and a lot of endangered species also live in these kinds of environments.
Oh yes, right. Like some half of the, almost like half of the forest species, threatened forest species in Finland are somehow related to these herb-rich forests. And also like those threatened species also need a lot of decaying wood for their, it's like a feature that they need for living.
So these areas are all protected, or how is it managed?
Yeah, so this place is totally protected, and because of the like the valuable like structures that we have here, for example, the large trees, the structure of the trees, and also the decaying wood. But we also have quite a lot of herb-rich forest in commercial use, and because they are so important for the biodiversity, so almost like half of the forest threatened forest species in Finland are dependent on herb-rich forests. So we have decided at Metsä Group that for our forest owners, we actually recommend nature management in these kind of places, in these herb-rich forests. And if there is a herb-rich forest with a lot of like good features for biodiversity, especially good ones, so we suggest the forest owners that it could be suitable for volunteer protection, where you also get subsidies from the state if you decide to have like voluntary protection for your forest.
And then no wood is coming out of that forest.
Yes, in these kind of places, like in some cases, like it's also good for the biodiversity if we do some like nature management fellings. For example, take out the shadowing spruces.
So how do you know that we are now in an herb-rich forest?
Oh yeah, like the first thing is like a forest expert should actually like like if he or she comes to a place like this, so he or she should definitely notice that we are in a valuable, like quite a characteristic habitat. And also nowadays we use quite modern technology, modern tools in forest planning. I can actually show you. So for example, we can see from here that we are now on this green area. It means that we are on a protected site at the moment. But we can use this application to quite a lot of other things also when we plan forestry or in forestry planning. For example, we know where the roads are good for summer or winter, or we can see, for example, the age of the forest we are in, or maybe the future forest management operations. And also important for biodiversity is, for example, that we see all important or valuable habitat nature sites here. And also, for example, we see the bird of prey nesting places, so we don't disturb when there are like small new bird of preyers growing.
That's great.
Yeah.
Who has access to this?
All our forest experts have this. And also we have an application for our cooperatives forest owners, so they can actually see the information about their own forest on their mobiles as well.
That's a great feature and quite the modern way of taking care of forests, I would say.
These applications, they definitely make the planning more easy, so that we see a lot of things already before we go to the forest itself.
It has been an extremely hot day today here in Finland, and it makes me wonder what kind of part does forest and forestry play in this climate change?
That's a good question. We know that the forest, they play an important role in both mitigating forest climate change, because the growing forests, they bind carbon from the atmosphere, and also both the trees and also like the soil, they also storage the carbon, so they are quite important. But one thing is that we also know that there will be more, so the warmth will bring us more extreme weather conditions, so it means, for example, more storms. And also the warming summers will bring us more, insects, which may be quite a risk to our forests. So we also have to somehow adapt to the climate change. So basically the decisions that we make today will last for example, 80, 100 years. So we have to take care that when we plant a tree, so we know that it will be resistant to the weather conditions to quite many decades. And also what brings more resistance to the climate change is that we also increase the amount of deciduous trees in our forests.
Yeah, so you plant different kind of trees.
Yeah.
In the forest.
Yeah.
All right. And it goes like that when we are producing the wood products, then that carbon storage is it continues to live in the wooden products, as well as when you think about the circular economy, that we are producing fresh fiber products out of pulp, like paperboard, and have to keep those good fibers in the loop and recycle, and then also affect to the climate change in that way.
Yeah, exactly. And also like the every time we are able to replace fossil based products with like these renewable ones, so then we also mitigate climate change.
All right. Well, then what kind of role does sustainable forestry play in all of this?
Yeah, well, at least we think that we like everything that we do, it's sustainable forestry. And not only like growing trees, in the economic sense, but also, or in the economic point of view, but also like adapting to climate change, mitigating climate change, and also biodiversity are really like essential parts of sustainable forestry. For example, one of the things is that what is like quite typical to boreal forest is that we only use like natural tree species here, and also supported by broadleaf trees. And also one important thing in sustainability is that we keep our forests as forest. And it's especially important for us as a cooperative, because we are taking care of our cooperative forest owners' forests. So we really have to somehow see like the long-term development in our forests.
Mm-hmm. And it sure looks like we have a lot of forest even here. We are situated some 60 kilometers from Helsinki city center, which is the capital of Finland. And as you will soon see in a drone picture that we'll leave right here, that we do have a lot of forests here in Finland, the green gold as we have, and we have to keep it in a way, take care of it so that it will last to our children and grandchildren and grand-grandchildren even.
Exactly.
Yeah.